is Not Sam Wrestling.
Introducing your host from New York, here is Sam Roberts.
Ladies and gentlemen, joining me at this time, because I wanted something special. I mean, it's WrestleMania, and I thought, if I'm not going to be used, I'm going to find the next most talented person that's also not going to be used for WrestleMania, and we'll use it for our own show. Ladies and gentlemen, here to help me make sense of everything we just saw over the last 2 days, you know him from the NXT TakeOver pre-shows. You know him from the Pat McAfee Show 2.0.
Thank you.
You know him from radio stations across this country of ours. You know him from the ridiculous schedule that he had in fall. He's a man who, after the schedule that he had with football in the fall, is actually welcoming quarantine like nobody that you've ever seen before. Ladies and gentlemen, Pat McAfee, what's going on, man?
Sam, I'll tell you what.
Yeah.
That was an incredible introduction. I don't call you the last professional broadcaster for no reason. That was amazing. I appreciate you. And I mean, quarantine life is definitely kicking a sack, but it's nice to nap at the house every once in a while. I was bummed when I didn't see you on Fox Sports 1 with Corey and Pete. Honestly, I really thought you and Rosenberg and Corey Graves would have been a nice little trio. And I was bummed out that I didn't see your beautiful brand muffin face ass up there.
Well, so that's what I was thinking. I mean, you know, I'm one for controversy, but it's still the thought crossed my head. Do you think it was a direct shot at both me and you, the fact that I turn on and I see Peter Rosenberg's on the kickoff show, and then the pay-per-view starts, and there's Gronk. They got Peter Rosenberg and Gronk, but they don't have Sam Roberts and Pat McAfee. I feel like they're coming right for us, direct and clear.
Yeah, definitely you. I mean, you definitely took some shrapnel here in this whole thing.
Yeah.
You're within driving distance of Stanford. Like me,
yeah.
I can make like the excuse, like, you know what? I was nowhere near where they were, so that's obviously why they didn't have me. And when it comes to me and Gronk, I mean, that guy's not only a Super Bowl champ multiple times, now he's a 24/7 champ. I ain't got shit on that guy, Sam. So I knew that there was no chance for me in this particular WrestleMania, especially after the short situation last year. But you should very much look at this as a potential shot across the bow of old Sam Roberts.
No, you're probably right. You're probably right. It makes me feel bad for all the times that I went on the TakeOver pre-show and I had to bring up the fact that you went to the Super Bowl but didn't win. And then I shouldn't have brought it up. I shouldn't have done it.
Yeah, because if you bring up that I go to the Super Bowl, all good. But then every time you pile it home, that, you know, we lost that particular game, they were like, well, we can't have that loser in. Let's get a guy that won. Insert Gronk.
Yeah.
Doing Gronk stuff, jumping off a damn platform, winning 24/7 title away from his old best friend. You know what?
What?
Sam, let's get right into it. I had no idea what to expect out of these folks. I had no clue what to expect. How are they going to separate WrestleMania, the grandest stage of them all, from SmackDown, Raw, NXT with no fans? How are they going to do it? And you know what? I think the Undertaker AJ thing, I think, was magical. I think the Firefly Funhouse thing was awesome. I loved a Randy Orton Edge tour around the Performance Center with some crazy stuff. That I think they did step up their game, and they were against all odds to really make an entertaining piece, especially in a world that revolves around fans' reactions.
Yeah, and I mean, especially when you, and this is something we were talking about, like, they hadn't done, WWE as a brand, NXT had done a couple of empty building shows that were pretty wrestling heavy, but Raw, SmackDown, even when they were doing shows in the Performance Center, they were not doing wrestling heavy shows. They were doing shows that were promo heavy, you know, archive heavy.
Hey, they were cutting promos like this.
Real close. Real close.
Real close.
But I'm sitting there going like, wow, like that's a ballsy move. To sit there and go, well, we haven't done a wrestling-heavy show, but we will at WrestleMania.
The biggest one.
The biggest one. The biggest one of the year. And a show that a lot of wrestling fans are going like, oh, they shouldn't even do it. This is stupid. Here's the thing. And this is why I love WWE. I heard everywhere, this is going to be, people didn't say, I don't know if this will be the best WrestleMania or not. people said this is going to be the worst WrestleMania of all time. They said there's no question. There's not even a conversation to have. And I just watched two nights of WrestleMania. And I can start listing WrestleManias that were worse than the last two nights that we just saw. We did not witness the worst WrestleMania by a long shot. And I think that you're right. I think that it's because WWE did. So, you know, they looked at all the negatives and they said, how do we use these factors to create positives that we wouldn't have the opportunity to create? You know?
Yeah.
I mean, I think that, you know, I brought up Edge versus Randy Orton, and I said that I thought it would be better in an empty arena than it would be in a stadium. And I stand by that. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think you can get the same personal feeling when you're going all, and you can't even do go well, all over a stadium, right?
Well, especially in one that is pretty intimate, you know, like the Randy Orton Edge angle was the most intimate angle I've seen in a long time, right? I mean, it was like, hey, I love you more than you love you. You shouldn't be doing this. I like your kids. It was like a really intimate angle. So those promos, like a couple weeks back, I think it was like 3-4 weeks back, before old COVID-19 came in off top rope on everybody. Right. That 5-minute storytelling promo that Randy Orton did.
Yes.
On this, to end the Raw or whatever, it was Randy Orton's best work in a long time.
Yep.
Then you carry into the quarantine times, those Edge promos. Oh. I mean, it was just awesome. It was, you know, I watched that. I watched the 24? Yeah, the 24 on Edge, where he talked about how he did 99 episodes of TV and some movies and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how many people could have pulled off what they were able to pull off whenever it came to promo was. And that's why I think the level of talent that has been showcased these last couple of weeks has been next level. But to your point, the Randy Edge one, I'm not 100% sure fans make a difference. In a lot of those matches, by the way, that end up going all over the fucking place, fans can kind of get lost in that entire thing anyways, right? Because the people in the arena are watching the Jumbotron anyway, so it kind of loses the feeling. And it was, for me, the one time during these last two nights that I wish there was a real crowd there. Now, granted, Drew McIntyre finally winning the championship after 18 years and his whole story, that's awesome. Same with Braun beating up Goldberg. People would have loved that, right? People would have loved that. When Morrison falls off of that ladder with both of the titles.
Yes.
Right onto that ladder and then falls off and picks it up. Like, I think that would have been a moment. I think there was a couple moments in that match where the crowd would have been a part of the show. You
yeah.
know what I mean?
Yeah. So there were three for me takeaways that stuck out. Like, I wish I had an audience in this moment. Two of them you just mentioned. One, of course, closing the night. I still say, you know, I was watching with some folks and they said that they thought that they should have switched the Drew McIntyre Brock match and the Firefly Funhouse match, just because I think everybody was in that sort of like, what the fuck did I just see? Whether they liked it or not, and we'll get into it. But I think that people were hung over from that match, and couldn't even process by the time he hit those four kicks and won the WWE Championship, Drew McIntyre.
Also coming off a day where the Undertaker AJ thing sent up,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So it's like, it's kind of like the similar thing where it's like, how do we top a thing that was produced like that?
Yes.
With in-ring action. That's a good call, actually. The Hangover was 100% real.
And it's real. But at the same time, when you look at it as a historical document, as somebody like me tends to do, you want, to be fair to Drew McIntyre, right? You need to have that as the moment. Whether if you're going to do WrestleMania, the moment that ends the show has to be Drew McIntyre holding up the title. You have to present this as the most important thing that's happened at WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Because I'll tell you this, the last person that beat Brock Lesnar for the world title was Seth Rollins, and it was a year ago, and it was at WrestleMania, and it was in the opening match, and nobody cared, and it was not a good title reign, to the point that Seth Rollins had to completely redefine his personality to get over that hump. It was terrible.
Do you remember they moved that to the opening match too? Last minute.
Last minute
was bonkers. It was absolutely by there's people running.
Yeah.
Brock's leading off here. It's hard to follow. There's a reason why there's a set order of stuff.
Right. You know? You're over here throwing a tantrum because Michael Cole yelled at you about your pants. Everybody else is dealing with the fact that they're literally moving around the major matches of the card right now. You're sitting here going, well, still, I think I'm more important than all that.
Excuse me. It was not a tantrum. It was just a simple, hey, if you're going to talk to me like that, I'm going to walk the fuck out of here.
It's not a tantrum. I just threatened to quit the company.
Just don't ever talk to me like that. Hey, I want you to know that that is not how it goes. But hey, we got past it.
We got past it.
Forward.
Right.
But here, the WrestleMania, the thing, you know, I know that this has probably been echoed by everybody in the wrestling community, but the thing about WrestleMania that's so awesome is just the energy and the electricity in the entire city. Right. Whenever you go there.
Yes.
It is just, I mean, you got so many indies wrestling there, right? They're having their biggest weekends of all time. You got every city and just the fans. I mean, it's just, and now, by the way, the Raw after WrestleMania, I'm bummed about now too, right? Because that is where the crowd literally steals the show.
Right.
To basically say whatever. So there definitely are some drawbacks, but I think obviously in the time that we're in, for a place that gets criticized for having bad creative, I think they had some of their most creative times in the most crucial times, which is WrestleMania when you have no crowd access and you can't have everybody in the building at the same time. I think it was impressive as hell, to be honest with you.
Yeah, and for me, my three moments were the reason that I wish there was an audience there was because the moments were so good. Because they were good. It was the right way to do it, and it would have made better. So my moment number one is Drew McIntyre obviously winning the title. I think if you had that celebration, some fireworks too, you forget. Open air stadiums, fireworks everywhere. There's helicopters going. There's everything. You can't do that at the Performance Center.
Oh, and that picture too. The picture of Drew McIntyre with the thing.
You know what's, but the one genius thing that I noticed WWE did, because I saw the pictures from night one, is they brought the giant WrestleMania sign. So like I saw pictures of Becky Lynch holding up the title after beating Shayna Baszler, and the WrestleMania sign is behind her, and it looks enormous because it's on the floor. And I was like, actually, that looks cool.
They zoomed in on Braun, too. They had just his face with just the WrestleMania in the back. And I'm like, oh, smart move for later in editing.
Yes.
Whenever you start cutting this thing up with some crowd noise in the back. Smart. It's like, that's the things that they do, though.
Yes.
That is just like next level that I don't think they ever get enough credit for. It's like having to think about not just this night, but also whenever they retell this story later, how do they get the shots that make it look the absolute best, even though they're in worst case scenario?
Absolutely. Moment number two, I'm with you with the ladder match. I felt like ladder match top to bottom needed the audience because I found myself watching. First of all, it's weird, you know, because it turns into a singles instead of a tag out of nowhere. Yeah. But it is, I mean, it is what it is.
Yeah, T's and P's, the Miz, by the way, whatever the hell happened.
What'd you say?
Something happened to Miz, right? You know what they said?
Yeah, I think he got sick or something. I mean, I don't think he's got the Roni. I don't think he's officially got that. You know, God forbid.
He's my kids and a reality show. Have a little respect. He's a turtleneck tough guy, but COVID-19 does not care about turtleneck tough.
No, it doesn't. That's what we're finding out, unfortunately, every day.
Roni does not care.
No, it doesn't. But so you had that. But to me, when I was watching the ladder match, way more so than the Edge-Randy Orton match, because you're right, the Edge-Randy Orton match, the fact that they went everywhere, it felt like this personal rivalry, like it all felt like it made sense. When you watch a ladder match with no audience, I feel like there's a part of you that goes, hey man, why are you guys doing this? Why? Don't do that. This is terrible. Why? I mean, this is brutal. Yeah. You're like, that looks like it hurts so much. Why? And then you hit the ladder and you just see the guy go, oh, ow. And you're like, I don't even, there's no energy to fuel me through, you know, the terrible things that you're doing to yourself right now. You know what I mean?
I thought a couple of times, I was like, man, I can't believe they're doing this with nobody out there. Like
yeah.
That, you know, like the Morris, obviously the Morrison fall. And then there was a couple other, not a couple other, there was all those ladder matches involved. You run into just a ladder by accident with your elbow, it's going to hurt. Right? I mean, let alone falling on it. There were some things in that match where I was like, man, I feel like I don't want to say they're wasting it, but I'm like, this is insane. And then you remind yourself, right? To them, all year has still built up to this, right?
Yeah.
And I would assume that the message that's radiating backstage whenever they're coming in waves, because everybody can't be there at the same time, is like, hey, this is going to be our hardest challenge yet. Let's put on a show. And the dudes that got in that ladder match were just like, you got it, boss.
Yeah.
Let's go for it. I love it. Yeah. I very much loved it. I did not envy them, but I loved it. What was your third?
My third moment, and this is one that I hope doesn't get lost on people, but I feel like if this show was done in a stadium full of fans, do you know who would have had one of the biggest WrestleMania moments of the entire two nights? Your guy, Otis. When he and Mandy were together, do you understand the reaction that stadium would have given to old beloved Otis? He got the girl. Mandy was looking as hot as ever in that outfit of hers, and Otis gets to stand with her, and that's every neckbeard in the audience going, yup, he did it for us.
You should have seen the group text my office has.
Yeah, you got some neckbeards working with you.
Yeah, we're all in there, right? Just a bunch of idiots. We have a kid named Zito.
Oh, yeah.
All right?
Oh, yeah.
Zito's the one that crashed the RV into the awning last year. Zito is Otis's number one fan.
That's not when a shock.
When tonight happened, the group text just started from top to bottom of Zito in celebration. It was as if he won against Dolph. It was as if he beat up Sonya, who didn't want Otis to ultimately have the girl of his dreams. It was a massive moment. And now that you're saying it, I didn't think about that just because I was so happy for the guy.
Right.
Beating up the bully in The Truth Shall Be Heard, which is drawing people, you know, to go crazy on the internet. But the thought of the music that would be playing in the background in Otis turning while he's holding her and the whole Otis thing. I mean, that would have been a majestic Mania moment.
Yeah.
It still was.
Right? It still was.
He still shut down the internet. I mean, he was trending higher than Sam Roberts on commentary somehow.
Which is tough. Still
tough.
Real tough.
Tough. Hey, internet is a buzz when Sam Roberts gets on a microphone.
Yeah.
But that was, you're 100% right. I should have thought about that just because of the reaction in the group chat. That place would have been insane down there. In Tampa, oh my God.
Yeah.
Tampa just got Tom Brady too.
Oh.
The thought that Otis got the girl, it would just be, you're 100% right.
Yeah. So I thought that was special. But still, I was thinking, like, as we were leading into the weekend, I was thinking, okay, you know, kind of like the point that you brought up, which is WrestleMania doesn't exist just as this night or just as this two night. When it's too big for one night, it exists as two nights. But it doesn't
too big for one night.
It's too big. But it doesn't just exist singularly, right? It exists as this moment in time. And, you know, you go on the WWE Network all week, it was the best 10 WrestleMania matches, the best 10 matches of the last 15 years, Stone Cold's best WrestleMania matches, Triple H best WrestleMania matches. And these matches that were in the most atypical WrestleMania of all time are still going to be put on those highlight reels, are still in contention for things like that. And, you know, I walked in going, okay, if there's one match that's going to get to that level, it's Edge Orton. And I can't believe that as we walk out, I at best put Edge Orton in third place at best. I mean,
Taker AJ is going to that's going to be shown. That is going to be shown for years and years and years to come.
It's one of the best things like I'm sitting there going, like, everybody makes fun of WWE films. And then I'm sitting there going, whoever made Undertaker versus, whoever made the Boneyard match and whoever made the Firefly Funhouse, if these people are not getting award nominations for Emmys and Oscars, I mean,
by the way, push these people to the front of the line of writing shit for you. Let's get these people, honestly.
Yeah.
That Taker AJ thing,
mm-hmm.
whenever Now, the thought of Taker AJ, by the way, mm-hmm. AJ so talented, mm-hmm. Taker obviously the mystique and everything like that, but we've seen his last couple of matches, right? You have no clue how the hell they're going to be able to make that work, especially with no crowd. Then they're like, it's a boneyard match, and everybody's like, what the hell is a boneyard? I couldn't think of anything worse than a boneyard match. That's what I was thinking for, a boneyard match. And then the American Badass shows up on his motorcycle.
By the way, that's a point of contention for me. People are saying that was the American Badass, and I go, if Limp Bizkit or Kid Rock is not playing, it's not the American Badass. I said it could be. I mean, Undertaker is a character that evolves, and there was a little bit of American Badass sprinkled in there. I still think there was some Dead Man sprinkled in there. That's why I was so comfortable in the boneyard.
And he rolled his eyes. He wanted to roll his eyes whenever he was standing behind him.
Yes.
So that was intriguing to me.
Yes.
But AJ said a couple of times, are you a badass? Oh, you think you're a badass?
Right.
AJ said it. You know,
right.
So
right.
That's why I thought it. But I would have never in a I was almost like scared to watch that match. You know, I was like, oh my God, some cringeworthy shit's about to happen, and I don't want to be a part of it. And then while I was watching it, I was like, oh, this is genius. This is genius. And then wait, and with the hand. I thought it was genius.
Yeah.
And that's going to steal the weekend. Absolutely going to steal the weekend.
What did you think of Firefly Funhouse? Let's talk about it, because that is also, that to me, I was looking at my Twitter and I love when this happens. First of all, you know me, Pat, I don't travel into my app mentions all that often because it's an ugly place. It's an ugly place. I have to put my COVID mask on just to go in my app mentions.
Yeah, keep your blinders on, okay? Just keep it to the timeline, not the notifications.
Right, right.
Away from the notifications. Smart, by the way.
But I jumped in just to see, and I saw back-to-back tweets that were going like, are you, because I tweeted something nice about the Firefly Funhouse, about how it was amazing. And it was literally one on top of the other. You got to be kidding me. That was the dumbest thing WWE has ever done. And right above it, that was genius. The awesome. Most brilliant thing I've ever seen. How did you feel about the Firefly Funhouse match?
You know, and this is going to probably piss off some of the wrestling fans who always found me to be the dumb jock, right? Who is just getting a position when it isn't my full-time thing.
Right.
The reason why I appreciate it was all the shots at the business throughout the entire thing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they took shots at every single era of the business.
Yes.
Right there. Things that I never thought, hey, Vince McMahon would okay. Then there was things that I didn't think Cena would okay.
Yeah.
I mean, they exposed Cena a couple different times, and Cena is already a movie star. He's already gone. Why, if you're Cena, whenever you're this big superstar, you got Good Morning America or the Today Show, whatever it is he always hosts, those people are watching for John Cena. He's got all his other celebrity friends watching for him, and he basically exposed all of Cena's, like, attempts at becoming the John Cena. Then all the shots back in the day at the bad wrestling, good looking guys. I mean, there is just, I mean, it was everything that I never ever thought Vince McMahon would okay,
yeah,
or John Cena was okay. And ultimately, I think that's why I loved it so much, because if you knew what was going on, which I'm assuming I missed a few of the references and things like that.
Sure.
But a lot of the stuff, you know, I got. I just think the ability to be that aggressive in either pitching the storyline, like Bray probably was, right? Mm-hmm. Bray, like, here's what I'm thinking. And for Vince and Cena both to go, like, run it. Good shit. Words in there. That's why I liked it so much. Just because it was so aggressive. But the common fan, right?
Right.
Who's just watching WrestleMania because it's WrestleMania and they're told to watch WrestleMania. I don't think they had a clue what the hell was going on. My lady had no clue what was going on.
Yeah.
And I was...
And you're like, she's like, what's going on? And you're like, this is clearly, it's a wrestling match. What do you mean, what's going on?
No, I was like, hold on. I think I just froze there. I was like, oh, they just took a shot at Hulk Hogan right there. And my girl's like, Hulk Hogan? I'm like, yeah. It was the whole thing. So I think that's where the separation lies.
It could be.
And by the way, WWE doesn't normally try to appease to the super marks, right?
Right.
That's not normally their thing.
At all.
So I think that's why I think it was so interesting to me.
Yeah, I thought it was super interesting. There were shots in there. I mean, I don't know if you picked up on it. There was a reference to Nikki Bella, which blew my mind because I was like, I can't imagine John Cena would be a part of that. There was a reference in there. I mean, That
I didn't hear the Nikki Bella line. I didn't hear the Nikki Bella line.
When Bray starts singing, "You can look, but you can't touch," that's Bella's theme music.
You can look, but you can't. Oh my! See,
yes,
So there's so much packed into that thing.
My plan is to go through it step by step on YouTube and break down every single reference, because I feel like the people who didn't like it don't get it. Because
they
just
didn't see it.
No, they didn't see it. Because there was not one, you know, you watch a film, right? And you know when you're watching a movie and there wasn't one wasted frame of film in this movie. Yeah. And those are the great ones, right? Like there's nothing wasted. And I'm sitting there watching this like, oh my God, this is sheer brilliance. Especially to come from a place where there were people out there that were saying that they didn't like what was going on because John Cena was burying Bray Wyatt on his way to WrestleMania. Husky Harris in a mask. He was posting stuff. Like he was burying him, and he was going like outside of kayfabe, quote unquote, and bringing up, that he didn't bury Bray, that Bray's overrated, that this and that. And that's why people need to take a pause. Like when they think somebody's quote unquote being buried, like what if I told you that Cena's going to bury Bray a little bit on SmackDown, but at WrestleMania, we're going to spend 20 minutes in a movie, in a film version of burying everything John Cena has ever done in wrestling and also a little bit in his personal life and also burying Vince McMahon a little bit. And then we're going to make him disappear from the ring as if he doesn't matter at all. What if I told you that's where we were going? Would you be okay with it then?
I couldn't even fathom the thought of sitting in a room and Bray Wyatt pitching this concept. I couldn't even, hey, John, you can bury me like on the internet and on SmackDown. You can start, you can do whatever you want. And Cena's like, I know. I know when we're going into WrestleMania, everything I've ever failed at is just going to be exploited. So, or Cena pitched that, right?
Could
or
be.
Cena was like, hey, we got no crowd. How do we steal the show? This is the way to do it.
Just destroy me. Just destroy me. Just. And, Cena had been more open to it. You know, in the Ruthless Aggression documentary series on the network, which is very good, Cena brought up the fact that the beginning of Ruthless Aggression, which was referenced when Cena came in with those little shorts on, he kept missing the slaps. Cena looks at that as a failure. And he referenced that in the documentary and broke down a little bit of that, but didn't really hammer down. I mean, the NWO thing, like people were like, that came out of nowhere. I'm like, no, that's a clear reference to John Cena never turning heel the way Hulk Hogan did, even though all the fans wanted him to. Look, we can get into it all day. Okay.
Bro, because he is Hulk Hogan.
He is.
Hulk Hogan recreated. I mean, that's everything in WWE is cyclical, right?
Right.
Everything.
They were like,
everything goes in cycles.
They were like, we need another Stone Cold. We need another Rock. And Cena was like, well, what if I was the next Hogan? And that's the way it happened.
Okay, we'll go PG and we'll just sell a bunch of neon green stuff to kids.
And we did it.
Cena
changing like the little things, like when they did the scene where Bray was about to get hit by Cena by the chair, and Cena changed the t-shirt to match the t-shirt that was of the era of WrestleMania 30. Instead of wearing the green, he was wearing the black with the pink letters on it. Look, I can't waste it all now, Pat, because I'm going to do a separate show.
Hey, don't let me be a part of this, because you're going to get a lot of views on this. I don't want to be a part of this. This is your brain breaking it down.
I appreciate
that. I can't wait to watch this.
I appreciate that. Because I got the feels all over. I got goosebumps watching this thing, because everything. And then Bray goes back into his old character. I mean, it's just, it's brilliance and it's genius.
Bro, it's just like, I feel like everything Bray does is just so deep.
I
feel like everything is so deep. The fact that they tied this into, obviously, the original tie-in is that he lost to Cena at the WrestleMania a long time ago. That's why he just got buried by Goldberg and Saudi. It didn't even matter. They were like, that match doesn't even matter. He'll give up the title because ultimately what he wants is revenge on Cena. I mean, just everything seems so deep. And by the way, that's exactly how it's supposed to be.
Yes.
That's how it's supposed to be.
Like, yes.
That's how it is supposed to be. And I think that's why everybody's so invested. And over the next couple of days, just like the debut of The Fiend, by the way, or the Firefly Funhouse, just like the debut of these things, it'll take a couple of days for people to actually appreciate and respect it.
Yeah.
But boy, that Firefly Funhouse, it was a pre-produced thing.
Yeah.
Obviously, everything was, but a production
yeah.
that was not too similar to the Taker on AJ Styles, where everybody'd be like, oh, they got lazy and did the same thing. It was two of the same genre, two very different things. Crushed it.
Yeah.
Absolutely crushed it.
And I was sitting there after, as good as that AJ Undertaker match was, and I think that AJ Undertaker match, I mean, it took the entire night one of WrestleMania, that one match took it to a different level where people were like, even if they were feeling like, oh, okay, this was actually better than I thought. After the Undertaker AJ match, it was, oh, this was actually a good show, right?
Yep.
It took the whole thing to another level. And I was thinking, poor John, poor Bray, because they're not beating that. And when I watched them, and like the fact that it wasn't even filmed in the same way, they didn't use the same yep. frame rate, they didn't use the same cameras. It was completely, I mean, it wasn't even a match. It was all metaphor and
it was a rap battle.
Yeah, there's a rap battle in there. This was, it was like Vince McMahon brought in David Lynch and he was like, hey, instead of me running the show, David Lynch, you're going to run the show. And then we'll just see what comes up. And that's what we got. And it was just, I loved it. But I have
no idea who David Lynch is.
He did Twin Peaks. Very bizarre, yeah. Very bizarre filmmaker. Very experimental in his approach.
I have no idea. I wish I knew.
It's okay.
I wish I would have known that.
It's okay. I know very little about football.
No.
Very little.
You know that I went to the Super Bowl, but...
Didn't win. And can I tell you something? I didn't know that before I met you.
See, you learned that quickly from
didn't
Cole,
even know.
I think it was
probably Cole. Probably Cole took a nice shot at you backstage. And when Cole takes a shot at you, I think to myself, oh, if I did that on camera, it would pop Cole. Because he did it to you too. So I'm gonna do it on camera and pop Cole. That'd be good.
And you did.
Yeah, I did. Oh, yeah. I do.
I'm frustrated at what you say to me.
Uh-huh.
And then in my ear, I got this hyena, Cole, cackling. How would you rate this? How would you rate it? Do you score things?
WrestleMania as a whole?
Yeah.
Look, I mean,
don't think you can compare it to other WrestleManias. This is its own thing.
I think
It's its own thing that has to be judged against itself. And if you're going to judge it against anything, I think you have to judge it against other shows that are currently trying to act right now. If you see how anything on ESPN or anything
else,
everybody is doing this. Everybody's FaceTiming, Skyping. It looks like an internet. Everything looks like an internet show now.
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy that they've completely lost any semblance of production. Like, there is no... Everybody's just like, hey, you got a webcam on your MacBook? Okay, no, that'll work just as good as our TV cameras that we spent hundreds of thousands of dollars for. Just use your MacBook.
What's your internet like? 20 megs up, 20 down? Oh, yeah, that should be good enough. Just yeah. Call it. It won't be blurry the entire time. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm watching the FS1, and poor Booker T is wearing a tuxedo, but his camera's all blurry. I'm like, Book, you spent more on your camera than you did on the... I mean, you spent more on the tux than you did on the computer.
Did you see Christian had that nice tux just in his bedroom? He's just in the classic bedroom in the back?
Yeah.
I liked everybody got all dressed up. I liked court. You know what? So I think you can't rate it against WrestleManias. I think you have to rate it against the things that are currently happening right now. And to be honest, I think they got an A for the boat. I think it's an A. I don't know how you could have wanted it to go better. There's a couple matches I don't think were WrestleMania worthy. Okay.
Yeah.
I don't think the Bobby Lashley match was had a purpose. I don't think it was.
Yeah, that's fair.
I don't think, you know what I mean? I don't think it was there. But I think all together, as a distraction and escape with some good storylines and some creativity, I think they hit it out of the park, to be honest with you. And I don't think that is something I've said about a WWE product in a long, long time.
Yeah, I mean, I'd give it an 8 out of 10, probably.
Yeah, there it is.
Based on how bad it could have been, honestly.
Exactly. I mean, that could have been so bad. Oof. I was going in, watching, waiting for the train to wreck. That is
yes.
The reason why I was tuning in. And that did not happen somehow.
No.
Now, will that over the next coming weeks? Maybe.
Maybe.
But it did not at WrestleMania, and that's incredible to me.
What did you think of first of all, I'll say the Kevin Owens spot was incredible, jumping off the sign. Oh. I mean, talk about a highlight reel moment.
How about Seth Sell, by the way?
Oh, Seth was good.
You know how you get that, like, you can't breathe, and it's...
Yeah. Yeah, the wheeze.
Smart Sell.
Yeah.
Because you can hear it. I was impressed by that match a lot.
I thought, once that match became a no DQ match, that's when it was like, okay, this is on the list of the best matches of the night. Before, I was literally watching that match going, oof, this should have been a no DQ match. That would have made this a lot better. And then they make it a no DQ match, and I'm like, they must have something implanted in my brain that they have a pre-taped show that they just took my suggestion.
They probably do. There's a chance.
What did you think? Two, ironically enough, I think probably the two most controversial results were the two singles women's title matches. People upset. I mean, people just love the women of NXT, I think, because I don't disagree with either match, actually. But people were upset that Shayna Baszler lost to Becky Lynch, and people were upset that Charlotte beat Rhea Ripley.
So I like that Charlotte's going to Wednesdays.
Yeah, it's kind of amazing for NXT, right?
Amazing for NXT. It's amazing for Wednesday night. Charlotte is a bona fide superstar, right? I mean, she's athletic. She's everything that you could potentially want in a superstar. So now that that's going to Wednesday nights, awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome for NXT. And the matches that she's going to have with some of the ladies in NXT, I think, are going to be... Like, I thought about Bianca Belair. And like, I don't know what all they're going to do. But I'm happy that Charlotte's on Wednesday nights. And when it came to Shayna, what do they do with her now?
So, you know? Here was my thinking behind it, because I get that. And I'm not saying if Shayna had won, it wouldn't have been a disaster, because then you're building this almost like this female Brock Lesnar. But I think because of the way this match was led to, we had no time to see Shayna have any matches except for Elimination Chamber. So the fans that hadn't watched NXT, which it is a lot of fans that haven't watched NXT.
They did not like her, Sam.
Yeah.
People that did not watch NXT did not like Shayna. Because I was bummed. I was bummed about it.
Right.
Hey, this girl is I get scared around her.
Right.
This girl is the truth. And the people that had no idea of her, whenever she showed up, they were like, this is boring. This is this. And then I was like, all right, what are they going to do with her? Then obviously you get no crowd. Then you get a WrestleMania against the man. And then she loses. It's like, what the hell are you going to do with her now? I'm intrigued to see what happens then.
Here's what I think Shayna Baszler could benefit from. It's spending some time introducing herself to the Raw audience. And the way you do that is, it's one thing to eliminate everybody in an Elimination Chamber match. But I don't think that people look at that match and go, okay, well, she's beaten all five of those women. People go, okay, in the context of the Elimination Chamber, she won that match. But, you know, that doesn't mean that you beat all those people. So I think that Shayna Baszler has to go through and start beating everybody one-on-one. There needs to be a one-on-one match with Kairi Sane. There needs to be a one-on-one match with Asuka. There needs to be a one-on-one match. Now that Liv Morgan's beaten Natalya, Shayna Baszler versus Liv Morgan. And let's let the Raw audience see how dominant she can be, and then come back, and now she's really a threat to Becky Lynch.
It's interesting to me watching the NXT superstars, whenever they get called the Raw or SmackDown, and the debut kind of stumbles a little. Like after the Super Bowl, that halftime heat show happened, when they tore the house down for whatever 15 minutes or whatever, the Performance Center down, and then Gargano got lifted, Ciampa got lifted, Alistair got, like, everybody that was in there basically got lifted, and then they kind of stumbled out the gates, right? Like Aleister Black had the longest intro of all time that was very cool in NXT, and up on Raw, everybody was like, this guy is a longer intro than Undertaker. What the hell's going on? Then he gets hurt, it kind of like stumbles out, right?
Yeah.
Same thing with Shayna, how it like stumbles out the blocks. Watching them, like Aleister just got a big win, obviously, but watching that build back up is kind of fun to see, especially whenever you've seen somebody at the top of their game and the top of the world.
Right.
And then all of a sudden have to reprove themselves. It almost can add to the storyline in the end, which obviously that's what we're looking to do. Happened with Drew McIntyre.
Yeah.
Has happened with Kevin Owens and Seth and everybody. I mean, it's just, I'm intrigued to see what kind of, I don't know what they're going to do with Shayna, man. I'm pumped to see it, but I don't know what the hell they're going to do with it.
Yeah. I mean, for guys like us, I mean, you and I, Pat, we know that NXT is the number one sports entertainment brand in the world. NXT is the best wrestling on the planet.
On the planet.
Yeah.
And if you go into a universe, I'm sure you can dive to another planet. Maybe it's a little bit dumber planet or whatever. They have wrestling there, sports entertainment, just like our planet. NXT would be the best on their planet as well.
I agree.
It's the hottest brand of sports entertainment. Their shows are absolute chaos and insanity.
Yes.
So whenever you see these people get to the top and then bang, they kind of stumble out the gates of Raw SmackDown, it's like, all right, what are we gonna do with them next?
Because
Keith Lee, I thought it was gonna happen with Keith Lee.
Yeah. We forget, Pat, that there's a whole bunch of people that aren't like us that aren't even watching NXT. So they show up and there isn't this, people, there are some people who think that there should be this seamless transition where everything that you've done in NXT goes right up and you're on the main roster now and you get to just continue riding that wave. But hey, Pat, you're a football man. There's a lot of football men that are very good at football in university, and then they get to the NFL and they stumble. Because it doesn't matter what they did in college ball, does
true.
It? Does it?
Very, very true. Very, very true. But you know what?
What?
If you're good, you're good, dude.
You would know.
If you're good, you're good.
Yeah.
If you're average, you can trick some people for a long time, too. Yeah.
And then get a nice early retirement before they catch up to you.
It is. I thought it was a great weekend, though, man.
Yeah, me too.
I was pumped. Obviously, I was bummed that you weren't a part of the pre-show with old Pete and Corey, but I think it was a great showing by them, man. I honestly think they did well. I'm pretty proud of them.
Yeah.
I bet you it was a nightmare putting this all together.
I can't imagine. Just knowing what I know based on, you know, doing Wednesday night on NXT and like how much has been thrown around and up in the air and everything. Like this is, you can not, and I've been talking to some of the behind the scenes folks too. And I,
oh really?
Yes. And you are 100% right, Pat. Like you cannot take for granted, you cannot downplay how much work these people are doing to get this show off the ground. And the fact that we just take it for granted because we get WrestleMania every year, like, yeah, good, WrestleMania's on. It's some, you know, I'll get some Domino's contactless delivery because I'm not touching anybody. And I'll watch my WrestleMania, and then I'll go on the internet and complain about it. Why not? And it's like these.
What are you gonna do, Vince? You gonna sterilize some ladders? Put on the show, pal. Right? I mean, it's insane. The amount of work behind the scenes had to be terrible. I couldn't even.
Just thinking about the amount of people it takes to put on a show like that. Just taking all their temperatures must have been a nightmare.
Like, you all have to be below 99 degrees. You can't be part of the show. Even you, guy that we absolutely need to not have a temperature above 99 degrees.
Yeah.
We can't let you in here, though, because you could potentially kill everybody's grandpa.
Right.
I mean, it is. I don't know how they pulled it off. Sam, I have no idea how they pulled it off.
Yeah. But they did it, man. They did it. And I think that you're right. And I wanted to talk to you about this because we didn't talk about the show much. We texted a little bit last night, not at all tonight, because we knew we were going to do this. And I figured, though, you're a guy with a brain in your head. You would be enthusiastic about what you just saw. And honestly, inspiring. It's nice to see that when WWE's back is against the wall, they deliver a product.
Hasn't always been the case. I think everybody on earth can agree that there has been some moments here with WWE where we're like, there has to be something better than, there has to, with the amount of talent and the amount of brains you have, there has to be something better than this. This particular moment was a moment where literally the entire world was watching to see what they would be able to pull off. And I think they did it, man.
Look,
I honestly think they did it.
WWE is at their best for just how the organization works. When there is no net, when you've got a little cushion or you've got a little comfortability in your position, you know, that's when stuff starts to fall out of the grips. But when it's like, this has to work, everything is against us, we have to fight through this. When that's what's happening historically and what we saw this weekend, WWE comes through.
Well, sometimes you have to burn the bridge behind you so you have nowhere to retreat. You know what I mean, Sam?
I do know what you mean, Pat.
What you just said about WWE with their back against the wall, with their, when you're not comfortable and you have to put on a performance, they do it. That's what all the greats do, right?
Yep.
That's why WWE is WWE for a reason. But I hope the creativity remains the same. You know, I hope that escape that everybody needs can remain the same for the next couple of weeks or however long this is. And I'm thankful for the folks that pulled that show, those shows off.
Well, I know, Pat, that you have a similar philosophy to WWE. And for me, we all agree that right now the best thing you can do is get as much content out there as possible, create those distractions from the chaos that's going around in the world. And you are creating a mountain of content on a daily basis over at the Pat McAfee offices. So I would suggest that everybody just search you out on YouTube. You make it real easy to find that content.
Nah. Content's bad, but we are trying to listen. I think we all have roles in this, right?
Yeah.
We all have roles. I can't cure COVID-19. No, can't do it. I can't even come up with another concept that could potentially slow the curve down. But what I can do is dance monkey dance for all the humans that are stuck in the house. And I think that's what I'll do. I'll continue to do. I'm thankful you're doing that.
Yes.
I watch your show too on the YouTube. I love what you and Norton are doing.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.
I think on the other side of this, we're all going to be a better people. And Drew McIntyre is going to be our champion going into the era post COVID-19. I'm pretty pumped up about that.
I am too. Pat McAfee, thank you so much.
Hey, thank you, man. Also, obviously, Charlotte, Becky.
Sure.
You're good.
I mean, yeah. Champs. There'll be other champions for sure.
Braun Strowman too, by the way. Hey, what are we going to do with Braun? He had that massive, and then it kind of plateaued. They put him up against the Saturday Night Live guys last year. Now he's champ again. I'm happy for Braun.
Can I tell you what I think they're going to do? Who has the last pinfall victory over Braun Strowman? Sami Zayn. I think that the Artist Collective is going to start coming after Braun Strowman. That's what I think.
Hey, I like them a lot. I like Sami Zayn, by the way.
Yeah.
You love Sami, I bet, huh? You two are pretty similar.
I think so. I mean, that's a compliment, right?
Yeah, insufferable. Just, I think you two absolutely great at speaking and insufferable. I don't know what else you could possibly want from somebody.
Okay, good. Yeah, and we both have great beards, by the way. Great. We're good at growing.
Now, you see my
hair.
Little crappy beard coming in?
I do. I see it. It's good. It collects well under the chin, which is the important part.
Well, I got a couple of those right now, dude. Quarantine is I've been eating everything in sight.
I see. Yeah, for me, quarantine, the one thing that's really sucked about not being at WrestleMania this year is I'm sure you can see I really could use a nice maestro salute.
Electric maestro salute.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Pat McAfee.
I'll see you, Sam. Thank you, buddy.